People in Canada don't tend to think too much about water because we have a lot of it. So we have what I call the myth of abundance.
It's a gold rush type mentality. Anybody can access whatever volume of water they want, do whatever they want with it, and there's no regulation over it. We cannot afford to waste a valuable resource like our water.
There needs to be a huge raising of awareness as to how vulnerable and valuable and finite drinking water sources are.
You know, it's one resource that we see in our territory that hasn't been destroyed. And I think if we start managing it better, we would all be better off tomorrow.
The growing awareness of the need to protect and manage water resources is part of a resurgent global trend, but the concept is not a new one. In North America, protection of community drinking watersheds began in the late 1800s, based on principles of protection developed and established in Europe and Russia. Natural forests and wetlands were recognized as the ultimate filtering and purification systems. In British Columbia, those principles became well established, and watershed reserves were off limits for human activity. This trend began to reverse in the 1950s after sustained pressure and lobbying from industrial interests. Over the next three decades, various watershed designations were quietly changed from single-purpose managed forest lands to managed forest lands, and the logging of community watersheds began. The southeast coast of Vancouver Island presents a unique case for watershed management because almost all of the watershed land is owned privately. When British Columbia joined the Canadian Confederation in 1871, one of the conditions was to build a railway from Nanaimo to Esquimalt to connect Victoria by rail to the rest of the country. Coal baron Robert Dunsmuir used his economic and political influence to secure the contract to build the ENN Railway and was granted 2 million acres of land as part of the payment. The ENN land grant of 1884 runs from Campbell River in the north to Jordan River in the south, and effectively privatized all of the First Nations traditional territories in the area, as well as all existing and future community watersheds. The ENN Railway Company began subdividing grant lands and selling parcels immediately after they took possession. In the early 1900s, one island community took advantage of those land sales.
Over 100 years ago, the city of Victoria made a decision to purchase the land around the Sook Lake, as it then was, with the view to developing the lake as the water supply for the city of Victoria. They made the decision, they purchased the land, and ever since then, it's been a protected area, close to the public, and to put it in terms of today's parlance, the first step in a multi-barrier approach to protecting our drinking water supply.
The Capital Regional District actively logged in the watershed to help fund upgrades to the system. But overlogging and damage to riparian areas created several years of severe turbidity problems. Turbidity makes it more difficult to kill pathogens in the water, and increasing chlorine levels creates carcinogenic byproducts. In 1992, I flew over and then trespassed into the watershed with Vicky Husband of the Sierra Club and Mehdi Najari of Western Canada Wilderness Committee and documented the damage from the logging for a media expose. The resulting public outcry led to a permanent moratorium on logging in the watershed. Other communities have not had that option.
You know, the mountains look really nice on this side, but if you fly over the watershed and the mountains of the island, it's all clear cut, you know, and there's not a lot there left for that water to be flowing into our streams and our system. Watershed logging is a huge issue for us. Degradation of roads and culverts and those kind of impacts are shown in our river. To have a healthy forest, you need large woody debris, you need the sunlight, the shade, the fauna and flora. And if you look at a healthy stream, you need all the same things to have a healthy environment for salmon or fish. You start losing one and everything else is affected. We have a lot of surface issues from runoff from agriculture and industrial, and there's no snowpack in our mountains due to the global warming. That snowpack feeds the river during low flow in the summer, and you know that'll affect all our fish and all our wells in our territory. There's not enough water to be sustainable in our backyard, so we need to look after what we have, and that's the aquifer.
In 2003, the District of North Cowichan began a provincial and federal environmental assessment for a proposal to drill into and draw water from the Chemainus Aquifer. The water was needed for increasing residential development in the area.
90% of the aquifer sits under LALT IR2, and they believe they wouldn't impact us in regards to expropriation of that water. The municipality put in the infrastructure. We went to court on the judicial review in regards to the permit being given to North Cowichan without us being consulted and accommodated in the process. They reviewed everything and the judge agreed with Halalt in that there was not adequate consultation or accommodation in the approval of the certificate. We haven't relinquished title to our lands or our resources, and water's one of the most important resources our First Nations utilize from birth to death.
The Halalt First Nation has no treaties with the Crown, but they successfully protected the aquifer using their claim to Aboriginal rights and title. The District of North Cowichan is now appealing that decision in the Supreme Court of Canada. The Snanaimo First Nation in Nanaimo signed a treaty with the Crown in 1854, but the ENN land grant privatized their traditional territory, which now includes the Nanaimo Community Watershed. The Snanaimo have faced growing problems with their water supply.
40 years ago, this Nanaimo Town Reserve, it's called, where we're at today, was the southern edge of the city of Nanaimo. The Snanaimo First Nation has six very small reserves. We have this 40-acre reserve, and then we've got three small reserves on the Nanaimo River and two minuscule reserves on Gabriola. We're one of the largest First Nations in the province by population. We have the smallest land base per capita in the country. Indian Reserves 2, 3, and 4 on the Nanaimo River are adjacent to the city, but they're not hooked up to city water supplies. A number of families have lived on IR number 2, you know, forever. They, for a very long time, were simply on well water. Many years ago now, that well water was no longer potable. It was no longer healthy to drink. Just up the road is the regional district of Nanaimo's dump. It's been there for decades. We believe there's a connection between that dump being there and the groundwater being polluted. What we've had to do for many years now is to truck water into big cisterns at a very high cost so those homes can have proper drinking water.
The city of Nanaimo uses the South Fork of the Nanaimo River for its community drinking watershed. It's approximately a 200 square kilometer area. All of this land was part of the ENN land grant and is privately owned. Currently, Island Timberlands, a subsidiary company of the multinational corporation Brookfield Asset Management, owns 86% of the South Fork watershed. Timber West, another forest company, owns the remaining 14%. There has been active logging in the watershed since the early 1950s, when it was owned by British Columbia's first chief forester, H.R. McMillan.
Well, we have a number of concerns with the river itself and the watershed in particular. Our goal is to try and get Nanaimo's watershed publicly owned and operated, maintained, and that's for obvious reasons. We think that the public is better suited to look after their own water supply than the private sector. So with Nanaimo building its infrastructure because of growth, etc., what we'd like to see is a more natural watershed, which is hard to get with a forest company working in the area. Not that it's impossible, but with the current methods of logging, etc., it's really tough to do both, to have a pristine watershed and have commercial logging going on in the same place.
One of the problems with private ownership and industrial activity in watersheds is that water districts and the public are not always aware of what is being done by the companies that own them. Prior to its purchase by Island Timberlands, the Nanaimo watershed was owned by Weyerhaeuser, another multinational forest company.
Weyerhaeuser used chemical fertilizers for several years in the watershed without even bothering to inform the Greater Nanaimo Water District. We were tree planting, and we'd get a big contract on Southern Vancouver Island with Weyerhaeuser every year. This granular fertilizer that Weyerhaeuser was using in the Nanaimo drinking watershed was just really noxious. I mean, there was people vomiting and skin conditions, nosebleeds, headaches, and we knew the stuff was toxic. We took a sample of the product to can test laboratories in Vancouver. Weyerhaeuser wouldn't test it. And it came back with very alarming levels of cadmium. That was the one thing that the lab technician was particularly shocked about, was the amount of cadmium in it. But there was also other carcinogenic heavy metals like chromium, strontium, nickel, and zinc, all in at heightened levels. We did some further research on these fertilizer products, and the particular agrium blend that they were using in the watershed, this loose pellet fertilizer, was constituted of a number of different suppliers of ingredients. Two of the suppliers, one of them was Woodburn Fertilizers of Oregon, and the other one is Fritt Industries of Arkansas. They're industrial waste recyclers. And their job is to go into steel mill smokestacks, and they clean out the smokestacks, and then they get all this ash, and what to do with it? Well, we'll just recycle it into chemical fertilizer products and just spread it across the landscape. Once we found out that there was industrial waste and steel mill smokestack ash in that fertilizer product, we did some further inquiries. We were informed that it was quite likely that there'd be dioxins and furans in the industrial waste. So we asked Weyerhaeuser in the city of Nanaimo, we raised the alarm and said, hey, you know, there's dioxins in those fertilizers, the most toxic substance known to humans. You should test for that. And they both refused. My most recent FOI package has shown that, in fact, the water district did go out and do a dioxin and furan test on those fertilizers, and the results were positive. There were dioxins and furans in those fertilizers. My estimation is that there's somewhere between 60 and 75 tons of that product still sitting there in the Nanaimo drinking watershed.
Interviews with the logging companies working in the Nanaimo watershed, both past and present, have yielded similar results. During a 2004 tour with Weyerhaeuser and the city, when this video footage was shot, I was given the following quote from Weyerhaeuser. Our logging is done in a way that will not have any negative effects on our water in Nanaimo. In 2011, I was told the following by Island Timberlands. It's very important that we work well with the city, which we do on a continuing basis for the water quality that the residents of Nanaimo drink. In 2004, when I asked the city about the use of fertilizer in the watershed, I was given this quote. We have a very good relationship with Weyerhaeuser and are constantly looking at ways to improve the system. They've done extensive testing. We've done our own testing to confirm the results that they find are the same. We've found no impacts on the water. Both sets of results have mirrored each other. In 1998, the Auditor General of British Columbia did a study called Protecting Drinking Water Sources, with the Nanaimo Community Drinking Watershed used as one of 8 case studies. In the final report, there were many references to the problems that fertilizer can cause within watersheds, but there was no mention of fertilizer use in the Nanaimo watershed. Weyerhaeuser, which also had an aerial spray fertilizer program, did not disclose that fact to the Auditor General. Woodburn Fertilizer, now bankrupt, was later successfully sued for $39 million by 2 Canadian farmers who lost all the crops that they had used Woodburn Fertilizer products on. Without Ingmar Lee and his co-workers blowing the whistle and doing their own research, there would have been no public knowledge of the fertilizer being used in the watershed. The resulting public outcry stopped all fertilizer use in the community drinking watershed, but this example clearly demonstrates the need for legislation and regulations to protect watersheds from industrial activity. Logging continues in the watershed, and the City of Nanaimo has recently confirmed that there are no written agreements with the logging companies that guarantee the city access to the watershed. The City of Nanaimo is now investing $65 million to build a new treatment plant to comply with the BC Drinking Water Protection Act, which requires filtration and disinfection of water sources.
There's a lot of cost involved in terms of membrane treatment. We're only putting treatment in because we have turbidity. The reason that we have turbidity is because of the industrial activity that takes place in our watershed. We think that the better plan would be to buy the watershed, to look at alternative treatment programs, sand filtration, etc., which is much cheaper than membrane filtration, and put the extra money towards the purchase of the watershed. And if we can't purchase all of the watershed at one time, then maybe just purchase the important parts, the parts that we can afford now, but have a long-term plan to buy the watershed, which we don't see at the moment. We have an opportunity to turn Nanaimo's watershed into something like Victoria or Vancouver has, which is a protected watershed. It's protected by legislation, and we think that Nanaimo and many other communities on the island should have protected watersheds.
I think what a really significant success story in relation to water and between the Nanaimo and the city has to do with the city's water treatment facility that they've been mandated to create through a negotiation and arrangement with Nanaimo, who are able to say we understand that the city needs to do this and that this piece of land is a key piece of land to enable that project, and that the Nanaimo has concerns about, you know, every square inch of Crown land in our territory, but we understand that this will be of benefit to the City of Nanaimo, and that the city, as part of that agreement, agreed to provide water services to IR number 2, to provide a certain amount of value of infrastructure connecting into IR number 2 for the first time. So that's good. I mean, that's a very good outcome.
Logging is not the only industrial activity communities need to be concerned with. The ENN land grant also included mineral rights, and mining is a major threat for water contamination. A copper mine on Mount Washington, abandoned in the 1960s when the company went bankrupt, slowly leached copper into the Solom River, wiping out fish populations. The government spent millions of dollars and volunteers spent thousands of hours cleaning up the mess over many years. People opposed to the Raven coal mine application by Compliance Energy are worried about similar contamination and the threat to two community drinking water suppliers downstream from the mine, Fanny Bay Waterworks and Ships Point Improvement District. They are also worried that if the Raven coal mine is approved, it will be followed by an open pit mine of the Bear Deposit, which is in the Comox Lake watershed, the drinking water source for the people of Courtney and Comox. The actual mining and leaching it creates is one thing, but a proposal for the creation of a contaminated soil dump in a rock quarry as part of the reclamation process is a major concern for Shawnigan Lake residents.
The mine site opened up about 6 years ago here. Since then, the proponent has taken on an application for a contaminated waste fill site, and it's being located in the headwaters of Shawnigan Lake.
The mine site is located, as you can see, on a ridge. So the flow goes east directly into Shawnigan Creek. The mine border is approximately 15 meters from that creek. And the flow off to the west in the other direction is into a wetland through an ephemeral stream and into a CBRD park area.
The proposal, as it is right now, would put 100,000 tons of contaminated soil on a very small area every year for the next 50 years. One of the main things that I pointed out at a public hearing is that they have overlooked a very, very large aquifer that was previously undiscovered, and it's just to the south of the pit. But the other main thing is that there is a major fault line of limestone that's running through from Wrigglesworth Lake to Elkington Pond to Devereaux Lake to Stebbings to Brian Butler's Pit. It's a limestone quarry, and it emerges right at the South Island aggregate. Frank Slavin, who is the closest neighbor to the SIA pit and has been a stone mason for 55 years, describes this type of limestone as cheese. It is so porous, it's so permeable. So rather than putting a contaminated site on 200 to 400 feet of solid bedrock, they're proposing to put 100,000 tons of contaminated fill on a wet slab of cheese. That's just unacceptable, and they have not addressed it.
The community concern is with the mine pit itself, with other mining activity in the watershed, and with the level of deforestation that's occurring through the industrial forestry, both on Crown land and private lands. The issue we have in this watershed is that it is mostly privately owned, whether they're large-scale forest companies or smaller-scale private land ownership with very, very little Crown land. So we're dealing with mining operations that come under either the Ministry of Mines or under the F1 forestry zoning at the provincial level. And the local community has very little jurisdiction through the regional district to control anything in the watershed.
What I want to see done in the Shawnigan Lake watershed is move toward an ecological governance. So an ecological governance structure that would include all stakeholders, and that there was actually a body, a designated body, that was making decisions on all the human impacts and the cumulative effect of all of that. Taking a look at the entire watershed and saying what fits and what will actually maintain the ecological integrity of the watershed and to be able to sustain it in perpetuity.
Contamination is not the only problem with water. Increased development has led to depletion of supplies.
We're seeing the Yellow Point Aquifer starting to be drawn down to such a degree that there isn't a reliable water supply for the farmers or for the rural residents who depend upon it for their water needs. 30 feet from me right now is an old hand-dug well. It was dug in the 60s. We're not using this, of course, but it does sit here as a reminder. They got all they wanted out of this, 20 feet deep. And this time of year, we see a lot of water still around. It'll go down with the ponds and the creek. They all go dry during the summer. The other well is just up this way. All the creeks and the rivers and the water around here, the licenses are all taken. So there isn't any capacity really for additional water supplies to be found. So this is just a little cover for a drilled well, 360 feet deep. It used to go dry at the end of September, which was fine to get through the summer. Runs dry in June now. More and more we're seeing people truck water in and just try to live by rainwater harvesting cisterns and the like. And if any new development comes into this area, they must have a reliable water supply.
The Cassidy Aquifer is one of the largest on Vancouver Island, but it too is facing high demand from development and growth.
The Island Timberlands, the airport, City of Nanaimo, Town of Ladysmith, some of the other developers, they're all suggesting they're going to tap into the Cassidy Aquifer to supply the region's water needs. It's a vulnerable and threatened aquifer, according to the Ministry of Environment. With all these new users coming in, we're very concerned about whether there really is the potential to supply all those people. What is the capacity of the Cassidy Aquifer?
With increased development comes the threat of contamination.
With the airport being expanded and the runway going right over top of the aquifer, we're going to have de-icing chemicals, gas, oil, anything else that is going to eventually run off and go down into that aquifer. Because the aquifer is so shallow and it's in silt and sand, it's very, very vulnerable to contamination. So We have a lot of concerns over the industrial land in and around the airport.
Fears of what might happen in Cassidy are already a reality in the Parksville area.
We're in a catchment area for a well field that supplies water for 14,000 people. And the issue is really the amount of water that's being extracted from the well field and also the risk contamination risks upstream. There are a number of different types of contamination, and every bit of land use has an effect on the quality of the water that comes through the system. The water level historically in this area was all swampy. This whole region of the east coast of Vancouver Island, basically, we have 1,600 meters of hillside and mountains above us, and the drainage from that would pressurize, and many of these areas were spring-fed. So the groundwater table was saturated here, and there were creeks everywhere. So the pioneers, when they first came, used this as a good source of drinking water. And now the water tables are down 30 feet, 10 meters or more in places. And the creeks and the wetlands and the swamps and the springs have dried up completely and don't seem to be recharging. This is the driest fall I've ever seen here in 30 years. And there's no water. We can't find any water anywhere around. There are two utilities within this area, the City of Parksville, the Arrowsmith Water Service, and EPCOR is a private company. They're drilling wells deeper and drilling more of them. So there have been a number of wells drilled within this area and just uphill from here, and they appear to be going deeper. So the likelihood of being able to sustain the water supply is going down actually fast. So it means that the people who live around here, their private wells will probably run dry fairly quickly. In fact, some have, I'm sure, already. We're actually standing in a floodplain. It's Springwood Park, and it historically would have been saturated and flowing with water even now in November. But upstream, we have every kind of possible land use. We've got industrial, commercial, storage of materials, auto wrecking, pig farm, septic systems, thousands of septic systems within the greater area. And I've worked on the land and seen many of them have failed. They're not actually operating well. This area, electoral area F, had no zoning and planning until about 6 years ago. So it was commonly used to do for activities that wouldn't be allowed in many other places. And one of the activities is backhauling materials that wouldn't be allowed to be dumped. And so there's contaminated materials and junk and stuff have been hauled and backfilled into many of the gravel pits in this area. And the coincidence is that we're directly on top of the aquifer recharge areas for two of the big water systems here. None of the area outside the Parksville city limits are really serviced by any wastewater treatment. There's no storm system at all. All of the land uses, industrial, commercial, residential, all the wastewater is basically going into the groundwater. The septic fields, the runoff from auto businesses, auto wrecking, and industrial machinery, treated products and chemical storage. So the infiltration of all the waste products from the industrial and commercial zones are going into the ground. We're closest to the EPCOR, it's a private utility, and the recharge area is generally within this zone. This is a gravel deposit left by the glaciers when they receded, so there's really no or very little impermeable layers. The quadra sands have been dug out. A lot of the quadra sand that would act as a really good filter have actually been excavated over the years. The watershed that supplies the surface water for the Arrowsmith Water Service is basically the Englishman River. There are a number of tributaries to the Englishman that originate from farmland and these unserviced areas. So there is a considerable risk of contamination to the surface water supply from the Englishman. Yeah, so this is one of the kind of gems what not to do in a drinking water supply area. Down below there's about 20 acres of cars. You can't see that much of it. There is a fairly large graveyard. The system that runs past there is a creek that runs into the Englishman River, and within about 5 meters of the creek, there are people actually buried. The land before the cemetery was developed was a swamp. It was a beaver swamp, and it was drained, and the cemetery is actually in there. So they had to do a lot of lowering of the water table in order to make it into a graveyard. 20 some odd years ago, I realized it looked like there were problems, and we started testing water. Since then, I've written numerous reports and appeared at many different functions, taken hundreds of people on bus tours to show people what's going on in the watershed, and everybody is really shocked and surprised, but nothing really has changed. We're now in the Romney Creek watershed. How subtle was that? This is the pig farm that has an immense pile of manure. This is the small pile here. The big pile is at the back. And guess what's on our right-hand side? This ditch is Romney Creek. I've had ministry of people, I've had health people, I've had municipal leaders, I've had federal politicians around here. I get out of a bus, get a glass of water from that ditch, and say, would you be prepared to drink that? One of the comments I thought was the funniest was a local, well, RDN politician said, yeah, but we do chlorinate it. So I said, chlorinated picture is okay.
Trevor has made numerous offers to present solutions to Parksville City Council and the Arrowsmith Water Service, including piping water from above the contamination sites during high winter flow periods and storing it in sealed reservoirs for use in the dry summer months. So far, they have refused his presentations and are instead considering taking water from the Englishman River below the sources of contamination, treating it with chlorine, and then pumping it into a natural aquifer for storage. This will result in contamination of the aquifer, with no guarantee that the aquifer will actually retain the water for future use. The water supply in Port Alberni comes from multiple different types of water sources from multiple locations.
This type of system in the Alberni Valley with multiple water purveyors is a really good system to have because it's considered to be robust. So in an event of an earthquake or something like that happens, then it's better to have multiple sources of water with multiple purveyors so that you can maintain your water supply. The Alberni Valley had 5 designated community watersheds, but they were originally watershed reserves. 100 years ago, they were set up to protect water sources. No forestry activity allowed in them at all. In the 90s, they started looking at changing what activities they could do in those watersheds. They acknowledged at that time that they were very vulnerable and would need really strict, diligent protection in order to maintain the privilege of going into those places which were traditionally no-go zones for forestry. Now there are 4 designated community watersheds. Rogers Creek watershed lost its designation a few years ago.
Rogers Creek is one of 3 karst water systems in the Alberni Valley. Karst systems are cave systems where water drains into sinkholes and can surface from caves again elsewhere. They are highly valued water systems, especially in Europe, where they are recognized for their health-enhancing properties due to raised calcium and magnesium levels. Karst systems keep water cold and help to minimize microbial growth, but they are also very vulnerable to contamination from pesticides, fertilizers, and fuel spills. Karst systems can also be damaged by road building or other developments which can cause water courses to change. There is now active logging in the Rogers Creek watershed. The neighboring Cold Creek and Cherry Creek watersheds have also been affected by industrial activity, including logging, hydro lines, gas lines, the railway, illegal dumping, and recreational activities.
They build these roads and then they drive through karst lands. there's no awareness that they need to protect or preserve that water source. So there's road building, garbage dumping, and the public lack of awareness that it's a watershed. Up at Lacey Lake, there's this obvious picnicking area where people go and spend the day at the lake's edge, or they fish or whatever, but they're also doing other human activities. There was human excrement right on the banks of a drinking water source with toilet paper and everything. We tried to get funding to put signs up to say, this is a drinking water source, be careful. Up until recently, there's no signs anywhere because it's private land. The city of Port Alberni has now put signs up on the logging road that says Bainbridge Lake is a designated watershed.
These problems are not uncommon in multi-use watersheds, which brings us back to the Victoria watershed model, where human activity of any sort is restricted.
Our treatment costs are very low because we control what happens in the watershed. We have a very, very high quality water source. It's managed from the perspective of providing drinking water, and we restrict public access so that you're not bringing potential sources of contamination into the watershed. We have a very high quality water source. We added ultraviolet treatment in 2001. UV kills any parasites, bacteria and viruses. Chlorine and ammonia provide a residual disinfection. It's part of a trend right across North America that at the municipal level, water demand is dropping. Water rates have been going up. We've had a pretty comprehensive demand management program. We've had rebates in place for toilets and washing machines. We've also seen a change in regulation, so it's a combination of all those factors. But certainly, after the drought in 2001, there was a much greater public awareness that we didn't have an unlimited water supply, and we had to be more careful in how we managed it. We spent a total of about $65 million purchasing the leach. The decision was made with a minimum amount of debate. I think the politicians recognized the huge benefit that the decision made by the City of Victoria 100 years ago, and they saw it as a decision being made today that's going to benefit many generations into the future. The drop in our water demand, despite the significant population growth in the last few years, has deferred the need for tapping into the leach, which increases the amount of time that we have to rehabilitate and restore the leach to a more natural condition, to mimic the structure of an old growth forest, so that then we get all those benefits of the natural filtration that takes place within a natural watershed. And in the future, when we need the water, we'll be able to continue with the current approach to treatment. It's not always possible to do what has been done in Victoria. When you've got a multi-use watershed with commercial, industrial, or agricultural activities, it's very difficult to mimic what we've done in terms of purchasing that land and taking it out of its current use. And depending on the size of the watershed, it may not be economically viable. Very often the only solution is to put in the sophisticated treatment plants to purify the water for drinking.
Contamination and the overuse and depletion of water resources are not the only problems facing Canadian drinking water supplies. Privatization of water services and infrastructure is also a growing concern.
We need to be very, very clear that our water is being targeted for privatization by big companies like Veolia and Suez, because they're having a lot of trouble in the global south, where there's great resistance to the quality of service and the prices and so on they've charged. And they're looking for what they call more stable political climate. So they're looking to North America and Europe, and very, very interested in privatizing Canada's water.
The federal government is giving preferential treatment and preferential funding to municipalities which consider public-private partnerships, or P3s, as a funding model for new projects or infrastructure upgrades. Because these contracts are private deals, the terms of the contracts are kept secret for up to 30 or 40 years.
What happens is that when these companies have had their investment paid off, I don't know, maybe it takes 5 years, maybe 10 years, they still have a 30-year contract and they can be charging whatever they want to the customers, and then they start just reaping in the profit.
As the former United Nations Senior Advisor on Water, Maud Barlow has seen the problems associated with water privatization firsthand.
They generally raise the rates of water dramatically. They cut corners because they have to. They cut water off to people who cannot pay. I mean, they say we're a private business and we're in business to make money and it's not our problem. The government has to sort that out. And they cut public sector workers. I've stood in townships in Johannesburg where there are prepaid water meters, beautiful state-of-the-art pipes and taps, but between the pipe and the tap is a water meter that you have to get an electronic key, and then every single drop of water is charged to you. And you know, I stood there with one water activist who said, we have 80% unemployment here. There's absolutely no way anybody can afford this water. So the women go with their big buckets on their backs or their heads to the rivers that have cholera warnings on them, and that's the water people use, and that's why these diseases are coming back in such numbers in the global south. There's been a real fight back against these companies around the world, including communities in the first world, Atlanta, Georgia. They had a 20-year contract again with Suez, and were very, very unhappy with the quality of water coming out of the tap, and they canceled the contract after just 3 years.
Another major threat to public water services comes in the form of international trade agreements. Canada is currently negotiating CETA, the Comprehensive Economic Trade Agreement, with the European Union.
CETA will give European companies the right to come in and bid for all levels of competition for all public spending. The two biggest private water utilities in the world are Suez and Veolia from France. They're 100% behind CETA. They can smell the money. They know that it's going to give them a foothold in Canada. They're going to be able to come in and say, well, we have access to compete. If any community, municipality is going to privatize or even put up for tender an infrastructure competition, they can come in and compete. And if you say no to them and that you want to keep it local or you want to keep it public, they can say that's a direct threat to our right to profit under this trade agreement, and they can sue for compensation. CETA would open up all of our water services in Canada to competition from these big companies.
Other trade and investment agreements like FIPA, the Foreign Investment Promotion and Protection Agreement with China, are also a threat to our water systems. Investor rights agreements allow foreign corporations to sue governments in secret trade tribunals for laws, measures, and policies that put the public interest and the environment ahead of corporate profits. Recent cuts to federal environmental regulations and the environmental assessment process set the stage for investor rights lawsuits when future governments try to protect the environment. The China Investment Corporation, one of the world's largest sovereign wealth funds, is rumored to be negotiating a $100 million deal to purchase a stake in Island Timberlands. Many of the community watersheds on Vancouver Island are owned by Island Timberlands, and it is very likely that China is interested in more than just timber. Local governments have identified the need for more control to protect drinking water sources. In 2011, the Union of British Columbia Municipalities passed a Ladysmith City Council resolution to request that the provincial government develop a funding program that facilitates local government acquisition of both the watershed and adjacent land for those local governments with water systems on privately owned land, and that all activities in watersheds used for drinking water be subject to final approval and control by affected local governments and the Ministry of Environment. Further pressure on the provincial government will help to bring about these changes.
And this speaks to the problem.
There are others who feel there should be a stronger approach.
The Nanaimo Community Drinking Watershed has been stolen. It's owned by the people who've lived here for 10,000 years. I keep hearing people talking about, we've got to reacquire our watershed, we've got to buy it back. And I've heard talk about $165 million. Bullshit. Expropriation is too polite of a word. I say confiscate. We can take that land back, we owe nothing to that logging company, take it back and start to heal it from the top down. Thank you.
There are many things that citizens can do to develop a water commons framework, which treats water as belonging to no one and the responsibility of all. The Council of Canadians and CUPE, the Canadian Union of Public Employees, developed a citizens' toolkit for a project called Blue Communities. A blue community is one that adopts a water commons framework by taking three actions: recognizing water as a human right, promoting publicly financed, owned and operated water and wastewater services, and banning the sale of bottled water in public facilities and at municipal events. Municipalities across Canada, including Victoria and Nanaimo, have passed resolutions to become blue communities. Other organizations and institutions are also addressing water issues for the same reasons.
The Vancouver Island University Students Union is a member of the Canadian Federation of Students, and our national organization actually ratified a decision to pursue eliminating the sale of bottled water on campuses across the country in and around 2010. And so the following year, we began to do a lot of active work on the campaign and started promoting the idea that VIU should become a bottled water-free campus. And so after a fairly short campaign, we were able to, you know, make the case to the university community, including the administrators, the campus unions, and of course our member students, that bottled water was bad for the environment, it was completely unnecessary, incredibly overpriced, wasteful, and the campus would be better off without bottled water. And so after we pursued the campaign for a period of time, we were able to get endorsement from the president's office, and shortly thereafter we were able to announce that we were the first campus in British Columbia to eliminate the sale of bottled water. Part of the 90s was really an acceptance that people were going to get access to water in part through bottled water facilities. Like, people didn't really think about the consequences, and so our institution, like so many others, had a shortage of water fountains on campus. We didn't have the infrastructure necessarily to support people getting access to water. And I mean, our goal was never to stop people from drinking water. Our goal was to encourage them to drink the sustainable and safe choice using tap water. And so over the past few years, we've been able to increase the amount of water fountains on campus. There's filtered water, there's bottled water fillers, there's fountains to drink out of directly. And so that was one of the most important steps. We also had to engage in just sort of an educational piece to tell people that VIU was the first campus in the province to go bottled water free, and that they could access water through one of the many fountains that we'd installed. It did require sort of dealing with the campus vendors to just get them to buy into the process. It wasn't very hard, and we also had to work with our beverage provider to ensure that they understood that we would no longer be purchasing bottled water on campus. Tap water takes less than 1% of the energy of bottled water, and it's clean and it's safe, and we really need to make sure that we are continuing to put pressure on our service providers, our municipal governments, to provide free, safe water. And buying water out of bottles eliminates some of that pressure. So that's an important step for the environment, but it's an important step also for the future of sustainable tap water in our community.
We take our fresh water for granted, but we shouldn't be complacent. Natural water systems around the world are being purchased by multinational corporations at an alarming rate.
We are a planet running out of accessible clean water as the demand is going straight up. Those who control this dwindling supply of something we need for life, something the planet needs for life, are going to be powerful and they're going to be rich, and they know it. And they knew before any of us, myself included, I've been talking about this for over 20 years, that water was the oil of the 21st century. It was blue gold.
We need groundwater legislation here. The BC Water Modernization Act has not been passed, and that has to change because we cannot afford to waste a valuable resource like our water.
The Island Water Watch is definitely something that we need to ensure we have water for the future generations, which is our responsibility to our youth and our children that aren't born today. We're the stewards of the land, and we have to start letting the municipalities and the government know we are here to ensure there's something left for our children.
We would like to see water as a human right, and we just really want the public to be informed about where their water comes from, how good it is in the Nanaimo area, and how we can keep it that way.
The newest, most distressing study says that by 2030, the demand for water will outstrip supply by 40% in our world. Stop and try to imagine the human suffering we're talking about. This is human-made. This is the displacement, pollution, mismanagement, and abuse of water. And so it really matters who's going to make decisions around who controls it.
We wouldn't purchase air, and I don't think it makes any more sense to purchase water. It's free. It comes from the natural environment. There's water in our creeks. There's water in our lakes. We need to protect that.
We can actually provide excellent water for a very long time, forever if we want to, for a growing population. And we can do that relatively easily and relatively cheaply if we do it now.
There are going to be deepening struggles around water. And we are going to have to come up with some very basic rules to govern our collective management of this dwindling resource, this thing we need for life. And it needs to be based on water as a human right, that it's a carefully managed commons, it's a public trust. Actually, nobody owns it. It belongs to the earth. It belongs to other species. It belongs to the future. And we have to care for it and govern ourselves in relation to water so that it's here for future generations, because future generations have as much right to clean water as we do.